respected V.K. Garg sir, former chairman PFC, distinguished dignitaries on dais, ladies and gentlemen, a very good afternoon to all of you. I feel privileged for the honor bestowed upon me as one of the keynote speaker to this August gathering. Being a civil engineer, it is all the more pleasurable to accept this assignment on the invitation of, you know, the invitation from organizer Energy and Environment Foundation of this third World Water Summit 2019. This has enabled me to share my experience and lesson learned from my long association with WAPCOS Limited. The theme of this year World Water Summit respects the fundamental place of water in sustaining life and conserving environment. Before diving into the core drinking water issue, I would like to make an attempt at putting word to water by saying that water is world's most precious and one of the utmost threatened resource. Here I would like to quote from Atharveda, which refer water as elixir of immortality. I deliberately starting this quotation from Atharveda because water plays a major role in human development. Known as elixir of life, water is consumption good, production good, and environmental good, contributing significantly to the human development. There is no doubt that water and sustainable developments are inextricably linked. Water, once viewed as an infinite and bountiful resource, water today defines human, social, and economic development. It is a basis for all living ecosystem, habitats, and is a part of an immutable hydrological cycle that must be respected for sustainable development of humanity and its well-being. In fact, getting the right amount of water of right quality to the right place at the right time is the indispensable for all growth and development. Friends, we are living in a water challenge world where freshwater crisis is deepening with time. Because with world population of about 7 billion, we are still growing at a rate of about 90 million per year to stake their additional claim for Earth's limited water resource. Unfortunately, nearly all projected 3 billion people who world will be added by the mid of this century will born in the countries that are already experiencing water shortage. Ladies and gentlemen, though water is life, polluted water brings misery to the people, both in terms of money and physical health. This is because water has potential for both disease causation and prevention. Globally, waterborne and water-related disease, as well as chemical contamination of drinking water, cause around 7% of the total death. An estimated 1.1 billion people lack safe drinking water. 2.5 billion people have no access to proper sanitation. And more than 5 million people die each year from water-related diseases, which is 10 times more than average killing in war. By 2025, two-thirds of world's population is likely to live in countries with moderate or severe water shortage. In India roughly counts for 2.5% of world's land area and have 4.5% world's freshwater reserves, but it supports 15% of human population in the world, 20% of livestock population of the world, and also due to increasing population, the total renewable resource of India, which was 5,011 meter cube per capita in 1951, is likely to reduce to 1140 per capita by 2050. Any situation of availability less than 1700 per capita per year is considered to be a water stress condition, and less than 1000 cubic meter per capita as water scarcity condition. As India has a skewed water distribution, both spatially and temporally, therefore most of the region are already facing the water stress or water scarcity situation in India. It has been estimated that in India, 21% of all communicable diseases are water-related. It has also been estimated that due to water-related diseases, the country is losing about 200 million person-days. In the loss in financial term is about 36,000 crore. Thus, the country should be willing to invest at least part of this loss to provide clean drinking and sanitation facility to the community. The understanding about the adequacy of water resource in India will not be complete without appreciation of some of the facts which I am going to highlight. The first fact is that out of available total water resource, as much as 2/3 are available in Ganga, Brahmaputra, and Meghna Basin, which occupies almost 1/3 geographical area of the country. This means remaining 2/3 area of the country is having only 1/3 of total water resource of India, which in turn implies that 2/3 of India is not naturally deficient of water resource. The second point which I want to make is that most of the precipitation all over the country occurs in few days of year, most of which is lost in the devastating flood. It may be interesting to note that New Delhi gets same rainfall as New York City. The issue is not that the rainfall, but the distribution of rainfall annually. A fairly equal rainfall, more or less around the year in New York, allows normal activity throughout the year compared to the New Delhi concentrated rainfall during few days over 3 months skewed all the events and activities to be gravitated around the rains. As such, water supply varies widely in India. Can we bridge their variation by arresting the flood with so much variation? This doesn't seem to be a practical solution. Now the next question, third point, which I want to make, that can we use groundwater? This too doesn't seem to be a viable solution. There is already over-exploitation of groundwater. Groundwater levels are continuously dropping every year. What is being exploited in the name of groundwater is basically fossil water. Some of them are more than 15,000 year old, heavily contaminated with the hazardous chemicals. How long can this go on? God knows. Because even if the state may have all the money in the world to spend on this, soon the underground water aquifer will exhaust. Thus, the making use of groundwater cannot provide a lasting solution because there is already over exploitation of groundwater. The fourth point which I want to make, that will the small check dams or water harvesting structure suffice? While the small check dams, percolation tanks selectively offers tempting local solution, however, the erratic rainfall may not permit dependable use of a small water harvesting structure in the areas where local conditions are not conducive for check dams and hence are not very effective. As such, no universal solution can be found to tackle water crisis. Increasing population is further adding fuel to fire. In last few decades, India has shown remarkable progress in terms of water management, both in terms of provision of drinking water as well as food security. Though large part of the population has been provided with drinking water facilities, the actual situation is not satisfactory due to lack of equitable distribution of water, water quality issue, high unaccountable water flow, lack of proper operation and maintenance, and weak monitoring surveillance mechanism. If you take the present scenario, we do not seem to achieving these goals. In fact, we are on the path leading to crisis and future problem for large part of humanity and several parts of planet's of ecosystem. Hence, if we carry on the business as usual, it will lead to unsustainable and inequitable path. To minimize the risk, I have following suggestion to make. Suggestion number one, the water is a fundamental need and must be available to poor and marginal community. But to ensure access to all with the full cost recovery, especially from the poor, will be quite imperishable. The government has to subsidize to meet the basic need of poor, but should refrain from subsidizing water supply and sanitation in general. The second point which I want to make suggest that studies have shown that when water is measured, the consumption drops appreciably. Wherever the services are free, this results in inefficiency, lack of accountability, capture of subsidy by influential group, and poor water services. All these result in poor availability of water to marginalized people. Third suggestion, which I want to make, the in present mindset, majority of population is of the view that water is a government business. This, however, needs to be replaced by a model in which all major stakeholders participate at all levels. At local level, community-based organization and user association have got to more role in planning, managing water and sanitation facility. However, for long-term sustainable development, this participation must be more real than symbolic. The user must be associated with the decision making, how it is done, who pays for it. So we should not overlook the fact that water is everybody's business, water is affected by everything, and water affects everything and everyone. The fourth point which I want to make, that our concept of water and its management has to change. Unless the human conduct towards the water changes drastically, the technology solution will be of no use. The fifth point which I want to make, that it is high time to think deeper about water. The global challenge of both demand and supply, water is mounting. Growing population and economies require and pollute more volume of fresh water. So, therefore, We need to shift from more efficient technology in the crop production, which offer a huge potential for rise in water productivity. We need to have a blue revolution to ensure more job, more crop for each drop of water. Sixth point which I want to make, that the interlinking of river or intralinking of river may prove to be one of the solution, wherein water from surplus river basin is to be transferred in water deficit basin, but it has been plagued with interstate issue and environmental issue. Seventh point which I want to make, that there are people who see water by its use, water for drinking, for industry, for irrigation, for environment, it is all these, as if all these are a competing use, but in fact they are complementing to each other. So we have to see the water as a basic, one of the basin concept, and we have to apply integrated water resource management technique in place of current fragmentation in managing water. Last point which I want to make, that one of the constraints which is restricting optimal use of water in India is, as per the CWC guideline, we have to plan irrigation project for 75%, hydroelectric project for 90% dependability, and water supply for 100% dependability. But there is no clear-cut guideline about the dependability of water which should be used for planning of such projects. CWC insists for 75% dependable water planning, which is putting a constraint on the optimal utilization of water. So therefore, there is a need to shift intervention of Ministry of Jal Shakti to allow project planning conforming to CWC guideline, but allowing for the planning of water based on higher dependabilities, lower dependabilities. In last, I would like to say that though we have got remarkable achievement to our collective credit in water management sector, we have to go long way to accomplish our goal. We have very serious threat to what we have achieved so far. This country may soon face serious water crisis, both due to natural and man-made calamities. We have got number of good examples that we must replicate. It is vital that we take up the implementation seriously, taking a holistic view of whole approach. Thank you all.